welcome to episode 31 of the Monday Night Review. I recorded half of this already, but hadn't plugged in my microphone. I guess that's how we're going to roll in 2022. Happy New Year to everyone. Sorry that there's been a bit of a gap. I was busy getting what can only be described as early stages of gout over Christmas, and I didn't think we needed to listen to that. Also, the wonderful thing about a new house is that everyone comes to visit. So we've had lots of people here, which has been really lovely, but has not meant recording conditions were at their finest. Unpacking is going well. We seem to have lost some vital things. My razor, my face cleansing tool, and half my stock for my stationery shop. So that's what I'll be doing later. But today, for episode 31, we are off to California, where, frankly, if you want any form of weird happening or true crime or one of the most famous serial killers, California is the place to go. And today we're not talking about a serial killer. Today we're going to talk about the very unusual death of Gloria Ramirez. At about 8:15 on the 19th of February 1994, Gloria Ramirez, a 31-year-old mother of two from Riverside, California, is brought into the emergency department of Riverside General Hospital by paramedics. She was extremely confused, answering questions but incoherently, and was suffering from tachycardia, which is the speeding up and then dangerously slowing down of your heart, and problems with her breathing. These symptoms were put down to her late stage cervical cancer, which she had been diagnosed with only 6 weeks before. So medical staff got to work right away. They injected her with sedatives, including diazepam, which are fast acting to drop the blood pressure, basically even out the breathing in the heart so that oxygen can properly circulate around the body. But Ramirez seems to have no response to this usually fast-acting treatment, so staff decide to defibrillate her heart. So as they are taking off her clothes on her top half, it's seen that by several people that she has this oily sheen covering her body, and some notice this garlic-like odour that seems to be coming from her mouth. Registered nurse Susan Kame puts in a line into her arm. She's drawing blood and she notices a strong ammonia-like smell coming from the tube. Now, when she's interviewed afterwards, Kame says that she's used to working on patients who've had chemotherapy and their blood can sometimes smell putrid. And she was very aware that this was not that smell. It was not the smell of chemotherapy blood, it was very strongly of ammonia. So she passes the syringe to Julie Gorczynski, who's a medical resident, and she notices manila coloured particles floating in the blood. She also notes the ammonia smell. And at this point, Kane faints. She's put on a gurney and removed from the room, and she says that as she's being wheeled out of the room, her face feels like it's burning. Shortly afterwards, Gorczynski herself begins to feel sick and lightheaded, and she leaves the trauma room and she sits down at nurse's desk, and a member of staff comes to ask her if she's okay, and she just slumps over in a faint. She is also placed on a gurney and she slips in and out of consciousness, convulsing and with similar unusual breathing patterns to Ramirez. Maureen Welsh is a respiratory therapist, so she's assisting in the trauma room. She's trying to get the breathing back to normal, and she's the third to pass out. And when she wakes up, she's unable to control the movement of her limbs, so she's having seizures. And it's now that Dr. Humberto Ochoa, who's head of the ER, and he's been working in the room the whole time, he declares an internal emergency and the staff are ordered to evacuate the whole emergency department and take all the patients to the parking lot outside the hospital. Any of the staff who've been in the room with Ramirez are ordered to strip to their underwear, and their clothes are bagged in sealed bags. So I've seen a couple of people saying that they should just have evacuated Ramirez, but obviously if it's a toxic gas, they don't know how far it's leaked. And we all know from the past couple of years, how important fresh air is. So
that's obviously the procedure. So a skeleton staff is left with Ramirez, including Ochoa, and they stay behind to try and stabilise her. But at 8:50 p.m. after 45 minutes of CPR and defibrillation, Ramirez is pronounced dead from kidney failure related to her cancer. Not everyone in the room with her was affected. The paramedics who had taken her into the hospital had stayed with the room, in the room with her for this whole procedure, and they were fine, as is Ochoa. This is going to come up later. Sally Balderas is a vocational nurse, and she goes back inside to help move Ramirez's body from the trauma room into an isolation room, and she begins retching and feels a burning sensation on her skin. And she too is soon laid out on a gurney, having difficulty breathing. In all, 23 of the 37 emergency room staff members experience at least one symptom. Five were hospitalised for the rest of the night. Balderas endures bouts of apnea, which is where you stop breathing for a bit, during a 10-day hospitalisation. But Gorchinsky is the most severely ill. She spends 2 weeks in intensive care, where in addition to apnea, she suffers from hepatitis, pancreatitis, and avascular necrosis, which is a condition in which the bone tissue is starved of blood and begins to die. And in her case, it attacks her knees, so she has to use crutches for 9 months. So the Riverside County Hazardous Materials team arrive at the hospital at around 11 p.m. They're looking for any volatile toxic gas that might be lurking in the air in the emergency room. So they have a whole host of noxious chemicals that they search for, including hydrogen sulfide, which is also known as sewer gas, which is an insidious poison. It smells like rotten eggs, but in high concentrations it can kill you after one or two sniffs. Phosgene, a gas which can be completely fine. It can be used for regular development of organic chemicals, but it, on the other hand, it can be used in chemical warfare, and it tears open the capillaries in the lungs and is a horrible cause of death. And some reports show that there had been leaks of sewer gas in the ER before, but to the relief of hospital administrators, they detect none of these in the emergency room at the time. So Ramirez's body is placed in a sealed room ready for specialised autopsy performed by doctors in hazmat suits, but this takes 3 weeks to organise. So then the autopsy itself takes 90 minutes, and the body's then placed in an aluminium coffin. They do another autopsy 6 weeks after her death, and a third just before her burial, which is a private autopsy done at the request of the family. So they find no sign of infection. It's concluded that she died from kidney failure caused by her cervical cancer. They send blood and tissue to the forensic science centre for analysis. Again, they find nothing unusual in the first tests. So they do further investigation and they find amine, which is a derivative of ammonia, which they believe could be responsible for the unusual smell. But this is believed to be a cause of the body breaking down the anti-nausea medication that she was taking, which is also found in her system. They find slightly elevated levels of nicotinamide, which is usually found in the body as a derivative of the vitamin B3, but it's also used in the production of methamphetamine, so we'll get onto the theories in a bit. Dimethyl sulfide, it was the third chemical found, and this is an industrial solvent and degreaser. In poorer countries, it's actually used as a painkiller. It's harmless and non-toxic, and again, we'll talk about this later, but the toxicology report declares there's no signs of dangerous toxins, and the state closes the case. While all these tests are going on, the county health department called in California's Department of Health and Human Services, which put two scientists, Doctors Ana Maria Osorio and Kirsten Waller, on the case. And they interview 34 hospital staff who'd been working in the emergency department on the night of the 19th. And they use this standardized questionnaire, and Osorio and Waller found that the people who developed severe symptoms, such as loss of consciousness, shortness of breath, and muscle spasms, tended to have certain things in common. They were people who'd worked within 2 feet of Ramirez, had handled her intravenous lines. They had all been women. A lot of them had not eaten that day. Other factors correlate with severe symptoms did not appear to match the scenario in which the fumes had been released. All of those affected had normal blood tests after exposure, and because of these findings, it was believed that the hospital workers suffered from mass hysteria. Again, we're going to go into that later, but Gorczynski denies that she's been affected by mass hysteria, and she refers to her own medical experience as this evidence. She's the worst affected. She spends 2 weeks in intensive care with breathing problems. She then develops hepatitis, a vascular necrosis. She gets pancreatitis, and she in fact sues the state for this report. And that causes them to look again at the toxicology reports. And when they do this, they realise that one of the scientists looking at the toxicology report had read the DMSO wrong, which is the dimethyl sulfide. So dimethyl sulfide is DMSO. And it was, in fact, a dimethyl sulfone, which is very similar in structure, but with one more oxygen atom. And it's also not toxic. So 2 months after Ramirez dies, her badly decomposed body is released for an independent autopsy and burial. The Riverside Coroner's Office approves of this DMSO conclusion, which we'll talk about in a minute, as the probable cause for the hospital worker's symptoms. Her family disagreed. The Ramirez family's pathologist was unable to determine cause of death because her heart is missing and other organs are cross-contaminated with fecal matter, and her body is too badly decomposed. On the 20th of April 1994, 10 weeks after her death, Ramirez is buried at Olivewood Memorial Park in Riverside, and she's still missing her heart and some of her other organs. The distress that this must have caused her family. She's got two young children, a husband, are just horrendous. So let's look at the theories for what happened. So the first one is mass hysteria, which is also called conversion disorder. Now, as annoying as this is, and as rampantly feminist I am, it does affect more women than men. Now, this originally, when they first started talking about hysteria, it was always referred to women. It used to be used to describe women who were not doing what men wanted. But mass hysteria does happen, conversion disorder, and it does affect more women than men. Because the staff affected were female, the patient was a dying woman of cancer of the reproductive area, they believe that empathy would have been really strong, and because a lot of the staff hadn't eaten that day, it's believed that this will have contributed to the mass hysteria. So the smell of ammonia will have caused someone to faint, and then it would have been a knock-on effect, and because they felt such empathy for the patient, etc. However, they weren't dealing with anything particularly gory. For those of us who are a bit blah about medical stuff, it would have been unpleasant. But for an ER department staff, drawing blood, defibrillating someone, when you have dealt with, you know, massive traffic accidents and probably serial killers and that sort of thing, it's not a particularly gory scene. Gorczynski has extreme physical symptoms that can't be put down. You cannot get hepatitis from mass hysteria. There are maybe some things, the fainting, the vomiting, that kind of thing could be down to mass hysteria, but you can't get pancreatitis from mass hysteria. Though those who believe the mass hysteria, and there, as far as I can tell, there were no men severely affected, but it could be that the majority of people in the emergency room were women. The majority of people doing the things like taking bloods, being in close proximity to the women, were to Gloria, were women. So it could be that that's just how it is. We know that the head of the ER is male, but it's unlikely that you'll find the head of the ER doing the things like taking blood, etc. So those who believe in this theory think that Gorczynski was going to get hepatitis anyway, and it was caught because of the mass hysteria, as in it was caught by medical teams because of the mass hysteria. I don't think so. So the second theory is the impossible chemical reaction. Now, this gets a bit sciencey, but bear with me. So Riverside Coroner's Office can contact Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory to investigate the incident. And Livermore Labs believed that Ramirez had been using dimethyl sulfoxide, DMSO, which is a solvent used as a powerful degreaser. And lots of people in poorer communities use this as a home remedy for pain. You can buy it as a gel from any hardware shop, and apparently it works well for pain. So users of this substance report it has a garlic-like taste, though this taste is not reported by any of the medical staff who suffer as a result of treating Ramirez. It's garlic-like taste, they believe, explains why. They believe it explains why they would have smelt garlic emanating from her mouth. But in fact, there's no report to say that you smell of garlic. Some people have a garlic-like taste in their mouth. There's no reports that this in turn will smell like garlic to other people. So it would also explain the greasy appearance on Ramirez's body, but it's unlikely that she would have squeezed an entire tube all over her body. They theorise that the DMSO in Ramirez's system might have built up because of the urinary blockage caused by her kidney failure, which was related to her cancer. And there was a urinary blockage. So they maintain that oxygen administered by the paramedics would have combined with DMSO to form dimethyl sulfone, DMSO2. And DMSO2 is known to crystallise at room temperature, and the crystals were observed in some of the drawn blood. So they believe that as the blood turned to room temperature, the DMSO2 will have crystallised, and that's what they saw. So electric shocks administered during emergency defibrillation would have converted the DMSO2 into dimethyl sulfate, DMSO4, which is highly toxic, and exposure could have caused some of the reported symptoms of the emergency department staff. So the Livermore scientists suggest that the change in temperature of the blood drawn from 98.6 Fahrenheit, 37 degrees, to the 18 degrees of the emergency department may have contributed to the conversion from DMSO2 into DMSO4. This hasn't been confirmed, though. We also know that the toxicology report was initially wrong, and the DMSO that was found in her system was actually DMSO2, which has no medical benefits and would have no reason for being in her body. Look, this really divides scientists, this, because lots of them maintain that this chemical reaction has never taken place outside of a science lab, and though DMSO4 is highly toxic and often used in chemical warfare, no one displayed the initial reaction, which is overproduction of tears. It's actually one of the chemicals used in tear gas, the first thing that you have as a reaction to this is an excess production of tears. So none of the workers experience this. The order of symptoms is always taken into consideration with dealing with toxic exposure so that they can work out what they're dealing with. And it would be really unusual for people who work in an emergency department, there has been a gas problem there before, to overlook this symptom. The staff also became unwell relatively soon after exposure. The exposure to DMSO4 will cause symptoms to start from 6 to 24 hours, not minutes. And that is what is a real problem for a lot of scientists who are looking at this. None of the medical staff showed that they'd had any DMSO in their systems, which goes against them being exposed to it. If you're exposed to gases or drugs or whatever, it will show up in your system. If they had had enough in their system to cause these problems and these long-term problems for some of them, it would show up in their system. Nothing. It all came back clear. So the family also maintains that she did not use DMSO. And there's nothing to say that police or hospital staff or anyone ever went and looked in her house to see if there was a tube of it there. It's not illegal. It's a perfectly legal substance. So there's no reason for anyone to have hidden it. Gloria wasn't doing anything wrong. This has never happened before or since. So it would seem that the family would be willing to find out what had happened, and they maintain that she did not use this. It's hard for me to find any information on what medication she was taking for her cervical cancer, which was described as late stage and metastasized. So her prognosis doesn't seem to have been good. We know that she was taking Tegan, which is an anti-nausea medication. But it's not unusual for people to take home remedies. I treat everything I can with oils. So it's not that it's unheard of for her to be using this. And if she was in pain, I guess you would be willing to try anything. But it just seems very strange that her family, you know, her husband's adamant that she's not been using it. So there's an alternative theory called the conspiracy theory, which is proposed by the New Times LA. And this is that Gloria Ramirez could have been exposed to precursor chemicals such as methylamine, which is used in the production of methamphetamines. So Riverside County has been reported as one of the largest methamphetamine distribution points in the US, and therefore they believe that allegedly some hospital workers involved in the production of methamphetamine, they smuggle precursor chemicals in IV bags. One of these was accidentally given to Gloria Ramirez. Now, the key element in support of this theory is that one methamphetamine precursor is ammonia and another is a derivative of ammonia, and that's what the doctors smelled when they were inserting the IV. However, you can buy all the precursor chemicals in chemists legally, so there's no need for the faff of the IV bags and the danger of the IV bags. There's also a belief that DMSO is sometimes used to help the absorption of the drug PCP, and that's one of the ways that you can effectively take it. You rub the DMSO mixed with the PCP on your skin and it's absorbed into your bloodstream. So some people believe that she must have been taking PCP. As a mother of two when I was 31, I can't think of anything worse than trying to parent whilst on PCP. And there is no, again, there's nothing to indicate. If you look at a picture of her, that she is, you know, there is nothing to indicate that she is taking drugs. Her family are adamant she never took drugs. And she doesn't look like someone who is secretly taking PCP. So the next theory is sort of believable, but so some believe she's got kidney failure. She's got a blocked urinary tract. This is down to her cervical cancer. This could cause a buildup of ammonia and ketones in the body. Kidney failure not only causes your body to be unable to filter things properly and everything, but also it causes a lot of other problems, which we see with her heart rate and her breathing, which can stop oxygen getting to certain areas, right? So she's having all of this buildup of ammonia and ketones in the body, and ketoacidosis causes a garlicky smell and an increase in oil on the skin. So some believe that ketoacidosis is causing this. It can cause pain, weakness, difficulty breathing, and kidney failure. The buildup of ammonia can cause crystals to form in the bloodstream. With so much ammonia in the blood, this could release some ammonia into the atmosphere when the blood is drawn. And this reaction to ammonia can cause a burning sensation, irregular breathing, loss of consciousness, nausea, and basically all of the symptoms of ammonia exposure tie in with what everyone is feeling when they're affected, except for Gorchinsky. She is always the spanner in the works, but again, people believe that she was already experiencing undiagnosed hepatitis, pancreatitis, vascular necrosis, and they weren't being picked up until she was being tested for this toxic exposure. But I feel like a healthy young woman with no symptoms, hepatitis, vascular necrosis and pancreatitis are fairly hardcore. So to not have any symptoms of those, although for me this works better as a theory, because your toxins in your body do build up, and ammonia is one of those, and anyone who's done the keto diet can say that they sometimes feel like they smell garlicky, their skin produces more oil. But yeah, it doesn't explain Gorchinsky's reaction. And so it remains unsolved. Her family, the case is closed. You know, they say she died of kidney failure caused by her cervical cancer. And that is probably what happened. But her family are not happy, and it doesn't explain really what happened in the ER that day. The hospital had reports of health violations and gas leaks in the ER before, and that was the first thing that was checked by the county. So it depends whether you believe that the county would cover it up to protect themselves. It just seems very odd. Her family are so adamant that she didn't use DMSO cream, and there's no reason for them to lie about it. What happened, if she had been using DMSO, and that theory is correct, none of that is illegal. None of that is her fault. It's never been reported as having happened before. So, you know, it was all an accident. So there is no reason for the family to lie about this. And they are very adamant that something's being covered up or overlooked. And so that is the strange unsolved death of Gloria Ramirez, the toxic lady. There is so much going on. I mean, you can go down holes in the internet for this. Nothing has happened before or since that is similar to this. And the fact that scientists, when you first hear about the DMSO theory, you're like, oh, okay, that makes sense. I'm not a scientist. I'm not very good at chemistry, but I can see how these freak things, you know, she has it in her system, the oxygen from the paramedics mixes with it, and then this happens, and then this happens. You can see how that would make sense, but so many scientists have said this isn't the case, it doesn't happen, it's never happened outside lab you know, controlled circumstances where it could happen. It's very strange. I'd love to know what you think. And thank you so much for listening. As always, you can contact us at The Monday Night Review, R-E-V-U-E, on social media. And you can send us an email at themondaynightrevue@gmail.com. I love to hear your favourite cases, your favourite hauntings, your family links to horrible things that has happened. I'm very sorry for you, but very fascinated at the same time. And I will see you all next week. And until then, be kind, stay safe, and always check the back seat before you drive.